Hi, I'm Cinnamon Cooney. I'm the Art Sherpa, and in about an hour, I want to totally show you how to do this fabulous fall painting. I'm going to show you all the steps, information about materials, a printout of the finished painting, which I think really, really helps, is in the description below. And if you showed up because you were looking for the live class, because we have live classes that we do Tuesday, Thursday, and Saturday, check the iCard because that's there. In that class, we add the beast from over the garden wall, which was super, super fun. But if you're here for just the landscape, we have that. Grab your paint, grab your brushes, grab everything you need and come back and meet me with Easel right now, and we're gonna get started. Let's go. So let's get started and look at our materials for today's really exciting lesson. I have a 16 by 20 canvas. This is pre-gessoed, and I get these in economy packs of five. Over here at the palette, I have the colors Mars Black, Phthalo Blue, Burnt Sienna, Yellow Oxide, Cad Yellow Medium Hue, Cadmium Orange Hue, and Cad Red Medium Hue. I have some of this acrylic glazing liquid by Golden, and I really like this because it slows down the drying time of my paint. And my studio is very hot and dry, so that gets important for me so that my acrylic doesn't dry too fast. I also have some titanium white here. So those are my colors. I'm going to start my painting with this bright. This is a number 10 bright. It's got a long handle and a very nice firm flick, and that's what I like in my brushes. I'm going to moisten my brush, but not get it wet. And I'm gonna start putting in my distant forest background. Whenever I'm painting something, I like to paint the things that are furthest away first. And so in my distant forest background, I'm gonna pull out a little of my cad yellow and a little white and just smidge some orange in there. Come here to the center of my painting, and I'm going to make this very light, diagonal, streaked light that's coming through my forest. I'm not rinsing my brush. I'm coming back and grabbing some white. And I'm continuing to add this forest light. Now, right here, this is the central focus of this painting. So I'm going to just really enjoy putting those diagonal strokes in. Something that you can do to help you with that is to see the corner of your canvas in the upper right and the corner of your canvas in the lower left, and try to have your brush strokes go from one to the other. Keep them parallel. Try not to mishmash them up. Take your time. You've got a lot of time. A little more yellow and a little more white. I'm gonna just enjoy this. I am enjoying painting this in. Now, as I fill this out, right, maybe a little more orange this time and a little more cad yellow, a little more orange. I'm going to darken around this center light. I can take these brush strokes all the way down to the edge, even though I'm going to be painting some ground here, or I can stop at about 2 inches from the bottom. Either is really acceptable. You don't really have to worry about that too much. I just grabbed a little more yellow to blend this out. See how I'm blending this light? But I'm really trying to talk about this light breaking through these trees here. Right, a little cad, orange and yellow and white, and then come down here the other side and sort of orange this up as well. I'm gonna orange it up in the bottom. Sort of fun to orange things up, if you can. A little oranger, a little deeper. I want the lightest part to be here, in that center. Have some fun. You wanna make sure you're covering the canvas. Right? Make sure you're covering the canvas, but don't work the paint too much. When I say work, I mean go back and forth and back and forth and back and forth till all the personality and tonal differences comes out of the paint. Do you see how that's just disappeared right there? It's just completely gone now. And we really want that there. So I'm going to put that back. I'm going to grab a little of my orange, yellow, my glazing, and come back and put that personality right back in. Right? But that's something that can happen to you when you're really new to painting. And never feel bad if you have something happen in your painting that you didn't expect. I'm grabbing some of my yellow oxide here. And I'm going to start bringing this deeper, richer yellow to the outer edge of my forest. Just lightly brush stroking this in. On the flat, you can see the stroke. I'm just pushing it in, but not overworking that. As we're coming to the outer edges, I want to make sure that I gray this out. So I'm going to grab the smallest amount of black. You can see how little of that is on my brush. And I come over here to the yellow. I'm working from the outside. I don't just mix these two together because that would use up all my paint. And I wouldn't really get the color mixture that I'm trying to get. Wouldn't really get it. And that wouldn't be as satisfying. So see, it's just on the tip there, right there. If you didn't have glazing medium, guess what? It's okay because water actually works in acrylic paint to help improve the flow. I have very hot and dry conditions in my studio. So this has been a real help to me. And if you were finding that your paint was just drying too quickly on you, that could be a real help to you too. But if you're like, oh no, with water this is working just fine, then don't worry about that. So I've taken this darker color all the way up here to the corner. I'm keeping those diagonal brush strokes, and I try to keep them as parallel to each other as I can. You can kind of see how that makes that lovely implied line. I can even bring this darker color down here at the bottom. And I'm going to also start to darken this at the top. I'm going to do that by pulling out a little of my black. Now, if you accidentally pull too much black over to your yellow, your oxide here, sometimes this is called ochre, but we're definitely doing oxide today, you would just wipe your brush off and start the mix over again. It's okay. I'm just going to really maintain my diagonal strokes. And this is going to really give some depth to my canopy, which will be nice. I like that I'm going to have that nice deep forest with the glowing halo of light. That's one of my favorite views in a forest. I'm really enjoying this. If you'd like to know more about blending or glazing mediums or things that slow down the drying time of paint, check out our big art quest, which is a weekly, it's a every week event where we get together and we talk about what the stuff is in the art stores, the difference of brushes, information about paint, more things that you might like to know. It goes on every week. You can start it at any time, and there's quite a large community doing it. It's really a fun group. So if that's something, if you want to know more about paint, that's something that you can do. I'm going to just keep pulling this nice, wonderful, smoky color all around here. I'm going to take this all the way over here. It's very nice. Blend. The shadow is encroaching into the forest. Trying to pay attention to my wonderful diagonal here. That's a lot of fun for me. Now, what I'm going to do now is create the forest floor, which is going to be about the lower third, just below it, of the canvas. So I'm going to rinse out my brush. And just rinse, give that a nice rinse out. and dry it off on my towel. And I'm going to do something sort of interesting. I'm going to pull out some burnt sienna, and I'm going to add that to the mixture that I had going with the black and the oxide. And I might even pull a little smidge of my phthalo blue, and this is going to give me a base for my forest floor. And I'm going to just go horizontally across. So you can see it's just horizontally across painting. Now I need this to be dark. We're going to be adding leaves and all kinds of things. So I pulled a little of my blue. You can kind of see the load on my brush. It's not up into the ferrule here. It's just at the tip of the brush where I want it. And I'm just going to horizontally take this back and forth. It's fun to mix colors. I like it a lot. Pulling a little of that. I really love when phthalo blue goes into burnt sienna. It creates so many unexpected colors when you're new to painting. And you don't think of blue and brown being so important, but they are. My trick here is I'm just keeping the brush strokes horizontal. And that gives me a nice little basis for the ground. Sometimes in art we like to call this the underpainting. And I'm taking my brush on the edge, as you can see. And my goal is just try to make this seem horizontal. Already we've got some landscape feel going. I'm going to wipe off my brush. And I'm going to give this a quick dry with my hairdryer. A little note on hairdryers if you've never used them on acrylic paint before is that sometimes acrylic paint can be very sensitive to temperature. And when you use your hairdryer on it, if it's very hot, it can do something called color shift. Sometimes it's noticeable. Sometimes it's not at all. It really just depends on the paint. And so try to keep your hairdryer a little bit back from the canvas and not such a high setting. I know that my painting is dry because it's no longer shiny and paint doesn't come off my hands when I touch it. So that's what you're looking for. And the next thing that I'm going to put in is trees. And to do my trees, I'm going to use this number 4 bright. You can see it's nice and square and has a nice edge to help me do a tree. And a little thing I'd like to say about trees is that they're thicker at the bottom and they get more delicate and skinnier and more fiddly as they go up to the top. So one of the things that you need to try to do at home is just try to remember that the thickest part of your tree will be at the base towards the ground, and they're going to get finer and more delicate as they come up. Try to remember to be easy on yourself about trees. Sometimes we have a lot of feelings about them, and that can come up in painting. So just try to be relaxed about it and realize your tree is a good tree and everything is okay. I'm going to show you how I do this. I'm going to make some distant trees, some faraway trees. And so I'm going to take a little blue and a little black, and I'm going to mix that into my white. And what I want here is a gray that has a slight blue cast to it. Not too light, because I have to feel and see the trees. And I'm going to come over here, and I'm going to start growing a tree up. That's how I think of it on my canvas, is that I'm growing a tree up. So I'll plant a little seed right there. Now I'm going to first grow up the direction of my tree, and I don't like it to be a straight guy. I like it to wander around. So yours can wander around too. But I know he's got to be thicker down here, so I'm going to make his trunk about like this. Well, that's not too bad. This distant forest tree. It's okay if some of the yellow is showing through him on your paint. That'll make it seem like he's in that light. And now let's give him some trees. Some branches. Right? First thing we're going to do is we're going to give this distant guy some branches. So to do a branch, I'm going to come up about a third from the top and just take a little line out. And I'm going to make it very light. How I do that is I have the most pressure right here, and as I'm coming out, I lighten. And then I'm going to make another little branch come there, and I do the same thing. This branch here needs to be skinnier than this guy. But what if I made a mistake? What if I went, oh, I don't like that? Uh-oh. That could be really upsetting because I worked hard to get my background. How could I fix that? Go ahead and rinse out your brush and dry the boo-boo. Now, if you don't have a very dark mark here, you can just come back with the paint you used at first to put in your background. So I'm going to take a little of my CAD orange and yellow, a smidge of white, and I'm going to just try to blend out the boo-boo. Here I'm blending that out. I'm going to get a little of my yellow ochre in my black. And I'm going to blend out my boo-boo. Just a little bit. If you need a little more ochre, sometimes it can be hard to match it, and don't worry about that. You're just fixing your mistake. This is just about repairing. You can put anything back. Just want to help the boo-boo disappear. Just go ahead and see how I'm sort of mixing that paint around, and that helps it feel like it's there. And I'm going to get some more of this orange and this yellow. Come right there and just blend this out. Just keep blending that out. There you go. It's just getting fixed. It's going away. Just becoming part of the distant forest that we don't have to be that concerned about. Now, it's so faded you can't see that at all. So another option for you, if you're having trouble with your branch, is to get what we call a detail brush, like this. This is a brush that comes to a very small point. It's not very large. It doesn't have a lot of filaments in there, right? And it's designed to make very defined lines. So you can come to your paint mixture here that you've made, and resting your hand on the canvas, very delicately pull out these little branches. So I'm very comfortable with my bright brush. I've used it a long time, so I can do branches with my bright. But if you're brand new to painting, you might not be comfortable with the tools. And it's always important that no matter what I'm using, if something isn't enjoyable, go ahead and just switch that up and choose something that's fun for you. All right, so I'm going to just enjoy these little branches that I want to have show in the far, far away of my forest, peeking out. You know, just enjoy that. Making sure that they're thicker and getting thinner. I'm loading on the tip of my brush. Just a little bit of fun as I pull them out. One of the things that it's hard for new artists to remember is to keep those, make sure those branches are long. Some of them can be short, but they should be fairly long if you want them to have that nice tree effect. So just ask yourself, if you're looking at your tree and you're like, I like it, but I'm not quite feeling it, what could it be? It could be those lengths of the branches. All right, I'm going to add some more little branches, you know, off in the distance here, and fill out this tree because I want him to have a lot of personality. And I'm going to give him friends. Right? I'm going to give him lots and lots of friends, but I just want him to be defined there. Now maybe I'm going to grab a little more black. These are darker trees. And I'm going to make some friends coming right here. These are going to just go up. They're just distant little, you can barely see them. You see their trunks, but you don't really know a lot about them. They don't really even have branches they're showing. They're just the forest. just coming here and maybe they cross in front of this guy. And they're making some nice depth and personality. And that's what we're looking for, is depth and personality in our paintings. I like to say drama on the canvas, not drama in your life. Sometimes paintings can seem really complicated, and they're not. So I've gotten those thicker at the bottom, thinner at the top. You know, you don't have to worry about these things. A little branch here and maybe a little branch there. Make this a nice far shadow. Maybe make a lighter little mixture here with a little blue in it. I really like that. If you need to wipe off your brush, if it's building too much paint up, you can do that. Nice little... And let's put some personality here. Maybe there's a little guy wandering up there. A little twig that has come out and has a little friend that goes like that, V's up. The harder I press on my brush, the thicker the line will get, and the lighter I press, the thinner it'll get. And that's just a fun thing that you can be working on when you're new in painting. Maybe a little distant branch here. These are some nice little personalities. Now I've got this nice mix of blue and black. I can certainly make some grass here. And what I do is I plant the brush stroke and curve it up. It's almost like rocking. And I'm just using this brush to tell that story of that distant kind of grass there. It also puts those things far, far away. And the blue looks really nice against the yellow. So that's a nice distant set of trees, but I need some other distant trees over here. So let's get our black back into our blue mix and get that nice blue-gray mixture going. And just making sure I've got some fluidity. And I'm gonna come here, and I'm gonna close the forest in on this beautiful opening. I'm gonna wander this tree, and I'm gonna wander it over to the left a little bit. Here it goes. I lighten my brush stroke, and that's how I taper that off. Let's thicken up this trunk. Let's make this a more substantial tree here at the edge where the path is going. Just enjoy that. You can do that. Just fill that in. That's fun. I like acrylic paint because you can make mistakes and fix it. You can just start any day. You can start really easily. A little branch wanders up there. And there I am. You can see me pressing hard at the beginning of the stroke. And then as I get out to the edge of the branch, my pressure gets lighter and lighter and lighter and more delicate, more delicate. You know, if it's hard to do branches, one thing that you can do is practice on a scratch sheet of paper. You don't have to practice on the canvas. You can sit there and say, can I get this stroke? And practice it. You can get a smaller brush to help you. You know, these are all good things that you can do. I'm kind of darkening my paint here. I want to add some more trees far distant in the forest. Much less defined. Just sort of have some fun here. Little distant trees. It's fun to have little distant trees. Just keep putting them in. Maybe they have little branches coming off there. That one went off to the right a little bit. And then it's going to come up almost the tip and split off. And right here I'm going to split them off. One of the things, try to keep those lines long. It's real tempting to make them short. To go like this, to make them so short. And then they have a different look than maybe what you're going for. That's okay. I don't need to do too much here because I'm going to be coming with like a little blue light coming in. But I just want to make sure that it feels like there's a forest back here. So I'm taking all these brush strokes up the canvas. You can see they're not that detailed. They're very relaxed. But now it's starting to feel even more. Even more. Grab a little more blue. And let's go ahead and give those rocking little kind of underbrush. You need to give some places for the mice and little creatures of the forest to hide. And I'm doing that rock. And so one of the things about my rock that you can do is I'm on the edge of my bristles and I'm rocking back and forth. And I'm making sure that my grass isn't neat. Try to make your grass unruly if you can. That's what's nice. Let that be a little bit out of control. And I'm going to do what's called a scrumble at the base here, which is just to go roughly scrumbly back and forth. I'm creating some shadow. See how that's done there? That's sort of fun. So I've got that there. I'm going to rinse my brush out. And now I get to do a really fun part, which is the fall leaf texture on the canopy up here. And it's super great, it's super fun. So first, take a little of the blue over to your burnt sienna. Not a lot, because you don't wanna change it from brown, you just wanna almost make it feel like chocolate, right? So it's still that reddish brown, but just a little deeper. And then, and this is fun, we're going to be kind of making this little curved shape right here. Just little dashes. I like to kind of sometimes even turn my brush a bit. Right? I like to. You don't have to, but it's nice for me. And so I like to share with you what I enjoy to help you. Because the goal is that you paint this. You have a nice fall forest. See, I'm dashing those around. I'm not repeating my patterns. I'm not making lines like that. I don't want to do that. I want to break up those patterns. Kind of like a basket weave. And I'm not going to take them all the way across here. And I'm going to come from this side. I'm also going to add these leaves in that same curve with the brown and the blue, the deep chocolate. Just enjoying this. This is a really fun thing that I like to do. And this is in the shadows, so these are deeper. You can come back over here and get an extra dark color. You can add that. You know, create some more shadow. See how that's sort of happening on the canopy there? Other place that you can take this wonderful color, right, is here in the ground. Make little dashes on the ground. Make little dashes on the ground. Listen, if you like painting and you have something that you want to see, if you like painting a lot and you have something that you want to see, go ahead and in the comments below, tell me what it is you'd like to paint this fall. Whatever you're excited about, what you're thinking you'd like to learn how to paint. I pick all my content based on what you guys ask for. It's totally viewer directed. So definitely in the comments below, tell me what you'd like to paint. And while you're at it, don't forget to like the video and share the video and subscribe. And you can find us on Instagram and Facebook and Twitter and Pinterest and our website, theartsherpa.com, and in Houston now you can even find us on public access on Peg TV. So anywhere of those places. So I'd love to see what you're painting, but do let us know in the comments below what you'd like to do, what you're excited about. Give us that like. We need the likes. It helps us. All right. Let's get back to this painting. So I'm just going to keep adding. Oh, I keep wanting to go to that black, but that's not what I want. I want the blue. I'm going to keep putting these little, especially here on the outer edges, these little leaves, just little loose dashes. This is just saying that my forest floor, not all the way across though, just right here too. I got to leave this light room for myself. Got to leave room for light in your life and light in your painting. That can be hard to do. For both, hard to be optimistic in life and optimistic in your painting. That is okay. Don't worry about that. You've got this. Just pushing those in. It's a lot of fun, right? You can do that. Super easy. Lots of fun. I'm going to rinse out my brush. And I'm going to add some of the bright, fun colors. So now I'm going to take a little of my yellow oxide and a little of my orange. It's kind of not as bright of an orange. And I'm going to come right here and add these just up at the top here. A little bit of oxide and orange. So it's not a super bright orange, but it certainly has some orange in it. You can come back and even weave this into the leaves you've already put up in the trees. And something you might, you know, might worry you, but you don't need to worry about, is if a little of the pigment isn't dry yet, and you go do dashes, and the two leaves kind of merge and blend, that's okay. That's all right, especially in acrylic painting. It's amazing how much is just okay in acrylic painting. And I'm gonna grab some just oxide and just keep putting this little dashes, not too far down, just up at the top here, at the top. Wipe off my brush, and I'm going to get a little of my cad yellow and my cad orange. And I'm going to put some of these brighter leaves down here. Some brighter leaves. I did some cad yellow and some white there. I'm trying to just some light here. That's what's important. Some light. Little light in your life. Little light in your painting. Try to be optimistic about your potential when you're creating. It's real easy to tell yourself a lot of negativity. Tell yourself all the reasons why you can't do something. Of course, that won't help you do it. So you might as well tell yourself the reasons that you can. All right. I'm going to grab some just orange here. It's just sort of fun, and just put this bright orange. Just a little bit of it here. You know, that's nice. Super fun. I think that's looking very good up there. I like that. Let's go ahead and take some of these fun colors. I might need to put out some more yellow oxide. Now, some of you might be wondering why I didn't just have us mix red and yellow to make orange, and I'll show you that just real quick, because it does. But you can see that's a little different of a color, and there's so many oranges that you can get, and it can be hard to get this bright color if you're very new to painting. Really challenging, surprisingly enough. You would think that yellow and red just making orange would be the simplest thing in the world, and then start feeling like somehow you weren't getting it. But what it can be is really challenging, and I like to give you guys the option of just using the bright orange so you're not fighting that. But go ahead and play with mixing those colors too in your painting. We're definitely going to on our pumpkins a little bit, and we're even going to mix, just I think maybe for the top of our canopy, a little of the more bright red orange, and put a couple of these streaks here. Just a few to just really, really add a little fall drama. Drama in my painting. So see, that's there. But you can see that's very different than the pure paint orange. You can mix a lot of colors, but sometimes it's okay to use it right out of the tube. That's all okay. Let's mix up some more colors. Let's get some of this orange and yellow here and just be putting in some little dabs of leaves. You can just see I'm just dabbing those, just like I did the brown. Go ahead and weave it in. Weave it in. Sometimes what's happening for me, I'm gonna get some yellow oxide. Sometimes what's happening for me is that the paint is still wet, and then it picks up into my brush and it moves along, and that's quite lovely. And I'm just making these dashes. You can just see this is just a little dash. I really like doing it. It's a lot of fun for me. You can definitely put a lot of colors out here. I've got some just yellow and white right there, just dabbing and dashing. And I'm just trying to keep it focused here. You can, now an interesting thing is you can come right here, you know, right here. And it just creates a little path out into wherever that light's going. And then bring it forward. Isn't that nice? Any of these colors that you had up in the canopy, you can put here in the center. Right, creating some drama, getting that bright orange, and that drama, a little bit, and that's okay. I'll put out some more of my glazing medium because I'm using it super quick today. How you're doing, I hope you're doing great. Now that we have that wonderful space in, let's put in our big exciting trees. These are kind of wonderful forest trees. They're a little bit spooky. They're a little bit of a spooky tree. But you know, if you lived in the forest, they would be comforting elder trees. So it really depends on your relationship to these woods, doesn't it? And so I like to make sure that the tree has both feelings to it. And I'm going to take a little bit of my black and I'm going to mix it with my brown and even add a little blue to that for this tree. So it's not really just black. Now, my paint got a little bit gummy on my brush, so I'm going to wipe it off. Make sure that that's not out of control for me. And I'm going to put this large elder tree, this ancient tree in, and I'm going to plant it a couple of inches, like 3 inches over from the side, a little bit down from the top. So you see that's about an inch and a half, and there's some distance from the bottom. That's where I'm going to say he's going to start. And I'm going to just bring him up here and grow him right off the canvas. It's going to go right off the canvas. I'm adding a little more black to my paint. And I want to really thicken up his trunk at the bottom. I really do. He's in the forefront. Grabbing a little blue, wiping off my brush where I need to, and just filling in the weight of that tree. This isn't thick enough. I'll have to thicken this up a lot. Let's just add some paint here, right? Let's come over and make him really old and really ancient. So he's so much bigger than the trees around him. It's really helping define his age. Just making that beautiful dark color. All right, so it's quite thick, couple inches at the base. But as I bring him up, you can see I'm thinning him down. You can think about like how these lines are in relationship to each other. Kind of try to, even though they might be bumpy, try to keep them a little bit parallel. The way even a crookedy old tree might be. Even a crookedy old tree. And he comes right off. So that tells us something too about the size of this tree. Right, and the age of this tree. I'm going to thicken this a little bit. So I'm trying to tell a story about him being a certain particular way. You could just do black and brown if you wanted, but I like the little touch of blue. Wipe the brush off if you need to. And get, you want it just always on the tip there. Right, always on the tip. So I'm going to come here, and I'm going to take a big wise branch, right? This tree, tell yourself stories about your paintings. This tree is old and knows things, has forgotten things. And the animals of the forest love living in this tree. They do. It's home. It's very important to them. At night, you would see all kinds of little eyeballs blinking around this tree. Blinking at you. Whenever I'm trying to make the thinner branches, I'm always flipping this brush on my edge, but remember, you can go to a detail brush. You can, and it's okay. I think sometimes when people are learning art, they don't know it's okay that their painting looks a little different. They don't know it's okay to change your painting up a little bit when they're in a class, and that's okay. It's okay to put yourself in a painting. Bring a little branch out here. See, I'm branching it out. But it gets thinner. Isn't that nice? Little branches coming off here. You switch to your little detail. If you're not having a good time. Another little tree that I always like to, I like to say that, you know, maybe a little sapling is coming up here. Little sapling. Again, my studio gets quite hot, so you'll see me using a lot of glazing liquid because it's very hot and dry. Hot and dry definitely will impact your paint, but if you're in a, you know, if you were in some place that didn't really have that going on, probably wouldn't even be worried about it. And there's another little branch just kind of coming off here. Here's what's fun. I'm going to add some roots. This guy's got a big taproot. No, I guess taproot's one that goes straight down. But he's got big roots. And so these roots are going to come right off this tree right here and come down. Look at that root. And then another little root will go back this way. Some of it we're not going to see later. But let's go ahead and paint in this substantial root. This has got to hold up this whole tree, so, you know, realize it's got to be really substantial. It's got to be quite thick. But guess what the roots do? That the top of the tree does. It does the same thing. They get thinner as they're growing out. They get more fine. And, you know, they taper. And so you want to make sure that you're doing that, too, when you're painting this big root. Now I'm going to put pumpkins right here. So I don't really have to worry about getting this detail all in. I just have to worry about my tree. I'm going to pick up a little blue, add it to my mix, get a little white. Oh, I get this nice highlight. And then here, where's my light? It's right here in the center. So I'm going to highlight the inside of my tree. And I'm going to, like, use my brush very, very lightly. And it makes it super streaky. Can you see how it's streaky? So what is impacting that is my brush is quite stiff. The filaments on it are very stiff and sturdy, not soft, like a watercolor brush. And that helps just the paint just go right onto the tooth of the canvas, which I really like. And I'm going to highlight this little branch, maybe a little bit right there on the inside of this, just to show that the light is happening. You see how the... We'll highlight the inside of that guy for sure, don't we? Highlight that. Light and show that. And then along the top of the root would probably be good too. Just enjoy that wonderful old ancient tree. Look at that. How fantastic is that? That is just wonderful. Now I'm going to put this brush back in water for a second. And I want to add a little drama. I've already kind of got it mixed up. I've got this blue and the white right here. And I want to pull in from this corner just some streaks of this cool light before I put my next tree in. I'm just gonna definitely add some streaks of this cool light right there. My brush is dry. There's just a little bit on the tip of the brush. You can barely see it when I pick it up. See how it's just barely there? If you're not getting this kind of dry, relaxed stroke, what's happening is that your brush might have too much paint and be too wet. But I like that little bit of blue light, and I like putting that there. So it's there. I think it balances the painting. And now we're going to put this guy's tree friend across this path. So this guy has a friend, and you kind of know how that mixture goes. Listen, if you're really enjoying this and you're really liking it, you know, remember that if you check the info card, right, there'll always be more information. That's that little circle with an eye in it. If you guys aren't familiar with that, if you click that on your phones or anywhere that you're at, it'll pop out more information. Also in the description below, remember I've got stuff there. So extra information, materials, and things like that. And everywhere that we are, like whether I'm on Facebook or Instagram, there's always more. Because I want to make sure that you guys have everything you need. So there's always more information that I put there that you can find. I'm definitely enjoying my fall kind of forest. It's really, I'm looking at it and it's coming together really well. So that is exciting to me. So I remember what I did to make my first tree, and I'm going to keep mixing those colors, which is my burnt sienna, a little bit of my phthalo blue, and some black. And I'm going to create another ancient tree, but I'm going to do this in an interesting way. He's going to be a little bit off my picture plane. And that's a fun thing that I can do as an artist. By taking it off the picture plane, I'm telling a story that exists beyond what I can see. And so that's really fun for me. So to get this trunk in, I'm actually going to start way down here, and I'm going to curve a line up. And I'm going to have to imagine, and I love this, to use my imagination, to imagine the tree on the other side, what I can't see. So when I'm drawing this line up, there is a tree that is invisible to me, right? And it's wonderful to use your imagination. I think in regular life, we're not encouraged to trust our imagination. In fact, I think our whole lives, we're told to distrust it. And not believe in ourselves. And not believe in our dreams and our ideas. But in a painting, well, you can believe in the other half of that tree. And the forest that you don't see. Because it's your world. This is your painting. Everything here inside these stretcher bars belongs to you. So I've got this little taproot area down here. And I can make another little root that tucks behind his friend. And keep painting this up. Keep painting it up. Make a little more paint. Doesn't take a lot of black. Black goes a long way. So I'm going to just give myself this little root here. I know I've got pumpkins. They're going to be right here. It's knowing to layer these things. A lot of people ask me, why don't you just paint around the pumpkin? Right? Why do you paint if you know you're putting a pumpkin there? Well, one of the great things about acrylic paint is my ability to layer an object and layer what I'm looking at it and giving it great depth, because the paint dries very quickly and it doesn't bleed through the surface. It's an incredible media and I really enjoy it very much, which is one of the reasons I enjoy sharing it with all of you guys, is I feel like you guys might enjoy it very much too. That's why I like to share painting. It's because I think it just helps us to enjoy our lives and to be happy. So I'm just going to keep putting a branch. I think this asks for a nice little branch coming out here. He's a healthy tree. A little branch going up. Not really that little, because he's a big, substantial tree. He's as wise as his friend. And I like to imagine that in the forest, they get together and they talk about tree things. I always do that in my paintings. I tell stories about what's happening here. You know, painting is one of those things that it's enough just to do it. It's not the result of the painting. It's not your outcome or whether you make your living at it or not, but it's the process by which you get to do it that's really helpful. And I have this nice branch coming out here. So now I've got these two little branches. I'm going to go ahead and go back and add that highlight. So pull the blue into that. And let's give just a little highlight on the outer edge of this tree, this sort of interesting blue light. It's fun, isn't it? It's very scratchy and rough. That helps it sort of feel like bark too. So how fun is that? Coming up the inside here. It's gonna be so wonderful to be in fall. Whether your leaves change color wherever you are or not, now they do on your canvas. Okay, you have fall on your canvas. And there we go. A little bit of that. And now all we have to do is our pumpkins. Everybody loves a pumpkin. Everybody loves a pumpkin. All right. So the first part of our pumpkin is very interesting. I'm going to start with a little brown. Right? And you're like, wait, what? Really? Maybe a little red. It's quite dark. It's my first layer of my pumpkin. You may need to add a little blue. Oh my goodness, this is so dark. Hopefully it's going to show up well against the trees. So in watercolors, a lot of times you paint the lightest color to the darkest color. But in acrylic, a lot of times you go from the darkest to the lightest. And that's an interesting thing that's different. To do my pumpkin, it's kind of a squish circle. So I'll show you how I put it in. I'm going to put in my squish circle. And it's a little bit pushed down in the center. And now I'm going to just paint that the dark color that needs to be the base of the pumpkin in. We're going to come back with bright oranges and yellows and wonderful vines. But right now, we need to decide what we want right here. What do we want right here? And I think that pumpkin needs a friend. And so I'm gonna plant a little friend. Maybe this pumpkin is tall and goes behind the first one. There you go. See that? It's a little bit tall, little heart-shaped top, and a little round bottom here. And we'll paint that in, that'll be fun. So they're tucked by each other. We'll have to definitely put a shadow underneath them for those to really, really make a lot of sense. Red in that. And then I like, this pumpkin is a very weird little shape and I like it quite a lot. So I'm gonna come almost all the way over the right. I'm gonna come up, make my heart shape and then squish out a little body. It kind of reminds me of a squash. You know, pumpkins are in that squash family. And so you can really have fun with their shapes and not just do like a regular round shape. You know, your wild pumpkin that's growing in the forest can be very, very crazy shaped, and that'll be nice. And sometimes in being imaginative like that, you know, people will really respond to the painting very well. And then I think a proper little pumpkin, getting a little red and orange over here, just trying to change up the colors. Somebody kind of small at the beginning. And just right there, just a little round pumpkin. Not as big as his friend. And the next fun thing I like to do is plant in the center of my pumpkin. So get some just blue on your brush. And you're going to come right here and make a dark mark right there on that little pumpkin. And then right here, like about a quarter of an inch from the top of this pumpkin, one right there. And that's really gonna help you a lot. And I'm gonna get the blue, but I haven't rinsed my brush, and this is important. So it's not the bright phthalo blue, it's this very grayed out blue. So we're just putting these dots in here, and we just wanna make sure that they're not perfectly at the top. And that's what I'm gonna do. I'm gonna rinse out my brush. I'm gonna have some fun now. I'm gonna get some of my, interestingly enough, I'm gonna take a little of my orange over to my yellow ochre. You could also do your cad red over to your yellow ochre. And I'm gonna come here and I'm gonna start making the little pumpkin segments. And the first segment I'm going to make is the one right here. I'm going to just paint down a little segment, but not perfectly. Look at this. I leave a lot of the shadow still there. And I'm going to paint another little segment right here, but I'm going to leave a lot of the shadow. It's important to leave that dark, dark color. Really helps your painting. So just painting these little segments in. I'm going to make a smaller, little thinner, and yet shorter segment right there. See how it curves? And then this one is going to disappear a little bit. Maybe a little short one right there. And up over the top. And this is starting to give my pumpkin some of that round structure and pumpkin shape. So some tips I can give you to help you is that the segments up front will be bigger, and then as they're curving around this pumpkin guy right here, they get smaller. And that's what's actually happening. Let's try again on his little friend next to him. So he's gonna have a little bit of a highlight right there. Then this nice big segment down here. And another big segment, because he's one of those long, tall pumpkins. You know the ones I'm talking about? Long, tall pumpkins. I like all the crazy shapes that pumpkins can come in. I like all the crazy shapes people can come in. I think that's pretty awesome. I think we should celebrate it. All right, this pumpkin here, I'm going to come over here, and I'm going to have a lot of fun with him. Right off his little shadow. That's where the stem is. That's why I put that blue dot right there, is that helps me find the stem. I'm going to really, really accentuate by curving up, going down. It's almost like a soft S, the shape of him, and just putting in this little highlight. It's amazing how a little highlight of paint tells you so much about something that you don't have to say everything every time. That's one of the things I think that happens to people when they're painting is they feel they have to say everything. But you can. It's all right, but sometimes it's okay to leave some behind. So we've just put a highlight here and a highlight here. And then a highlight right there. And another highlight right here. And let's get our good friend in. Because you know they're good, good friends. And similar to our first guy, put our little segment in here. Segment next to it. As they come around in the radio like a clock, they kind of disappear and then they're longer up front. So we've got those great segments. Wipe off your brush, and then this to me is like the really fun part. I'm going to take some of my cad orange, even a little yellow, maybe a little white, and I'm going to put some really bright orange highlights. I don't paint out the dark everything underneath, right? I do this really dry brush. When I mean dry brush, I'm saying I haven't added a lot of water to my brush. It's quite dry. And the paint is grabbing the canvas as it comes off. And the brush strokes are very rough. Always back away from your canvas when you're painting like this, because when you're up close, it can seem like it's not working, when actually it's exactly perfect. Because it should look messy and crazy when you're up close to it, and beautiful and painterly when you step back a little bit. And that's the goal. I'm going to take this color, and I'm going to add a little bit here too. You get to do a couple really fun colors here. Over to this guy. This is almost like very yellow, just a tint of orange. Just defining these pumpkins. And now they're suddenly taking shape, aren't they? They're becoming real. I'm going to wipe off my brush. And for fun, I'm going to grab some just cad orange. And I'm going to come right here with that. You can even sort of define some of those little segments. Don't paint it all cad. Leave all the colors showing. Leave some of the painterliness showing. And then you're going to really feel like you did something very expressive. Add this bright orange. And just right here, I love putting that in. Super fun. I'm gonna come over and mix just a little of my cad red. Just a little. Just having some fun. Not everywhere with that, just a little bit. So that's pretty great. Rinse out your brush. And I'm gonna get a little of my brown and blue and make a mixture that's more blue than brown. And I'm gonna come under my pumpkin and make a shadow. Make sure that that's in a nice dark shadow. That's important to right under your pumpkins. It's nice and dark. Not as dark as your tree, but you need to darken the ground underneath them. I'm gonna come here and make sure the ground is dark underneath my pumpkins. Even this close to the edge of my canvas, I'm gonna do that. Now, with your blue and brown right here, add a lot of white to it. Well, a little bit. And let's put some grasses right here. Just flicking up on the edge of the brush. You could switch to a detail brush if you're not comfortable with the bright. Maybe a few little peeking grasses between our pumpkin friends. Just something to finish off our little landscape. A little bit right here. Just creating some ground. Maybe some could peek behind the root. You know. Grass shapes. And then the last little bit that you get to do, and this is one of my favorite bits, but does require the detail brush, is what I like to call the fiddly bits. And I think the fiddly bits are delightful. The trick about the fiddly bits is to get right on the tip of your brush and just very, very lightly, lightly paint. So I've got my blue and a little white. It's quite light. I'm gonna come over here and I'm going to curly cue up some fiddly bits. I like that in my head, I really do. It's like, oh, fiddly bits. Maybe a little stem off here. These are the little vines. And I enjoy this element on the painting quite a lot. There's a little stem maybe, peeking out. And then curling around. Woo! It's fun to sing in your head. It's fun to imagine where these vines will go. I'm just curling around. I really enjoy this. You can practice this on a scratch piece of paper first if you're nervous about it. And it's okay to be nervous at a new skill or idea in art. So I'm going to come here. I'm going to come around. You can just see what it is that I'm making little curlicues just using the edge, the tip of the brush. Just curling it around imaginatively. Another little curlicue there. And they don't all have to be perfect. A lot of times people, you know, are very judgmental of their own paintings. And they have an idea based on something somebody said to them. Not really based on fact, though. Just maybe something an art teacher said or a family member. And there we go! That is our whimsical little fall forest. And the last little part that you could do here, you could sign it. I'll sign mine. All right. Oh, I hope you had a delightful time today. I really appreciated getting to paint with you. I hope you enjoyed this lesson very much. And I really look forward to seeing you at the easel really soon. Come join us live Tuesday, Thursday, and Saturday at 11 a.m. Central, or enjoy one of the hundreds of paintings available on replay anytime.